wonderful welcome to our next edition of Leaders for Humanity. And you know it by now, Antoinette and I are always very excited when we are presenting our guests. But today, yet again, I'm super, super excited. And for two reasons. The first reason is that, as you know, we're always trying to build bridges. So in the past, you have kind of seen us courageously step over bridges from management science towards psychology, towards philosophy, sometimes towards kind of critical system thinking and other domains. And today we're going to venture into the wonderful domain of education. And hopefully we will, throughout this interview, make it clear to you why we feel education is another piece of our puzzle for that inquiry that we're on. And the second reason I'm very excited is because we have been able to convince one of the world's most prominent thinkers about education and educational philosophy, but by the same token, a true pedagogue, someone who is not only thinking about education, but who actually has been in education and has been teaching teachers even to this dialogue with us. And without further ado, I would say a very warm welcome today in Scotland, Gert Biesta. Thank you so much for making time for us.
Okay. Thanks for the welcome. My pleasure. Looking forward to it.
Beautiful. And with that, I will, as usual, go briefly into the agenda. As always, I will say two words about our good organization inquiry and try already a little bit to contextualize that with the conversation of today, which is about reinventing education. And then Antoinette, as always, will do the honors and properly introduce Gert. And then, as usual, we will ask Gert to present himself and enter into the dialogue. So a quick word on the good organizations inquiry, and I'm not going to repeat myself much. As always, we are on a quest to understand how to create organizations that can act for good in this complex and kind of ever-changing 21st century. How can organizations be positive actors in society? How can they create communities and stakeholders that flourish? And how can they become a breeding ground? And here, I want to choose my words carefully today for the education and what education means in the context of EdSihonk. Gert, I'm sure, will explain to us, for the development and the flourishing of the individual. So how can our organizations become work as an end in itself? And in this context, we have already, as you know, spoken to many, many very interesting people who in our mind are wise leaders for humanity, who can bridge those different disciplines and, most importantly, theory and practice, and help us to guide this inquiry that we're on, and sometimes also to provide critical thoughts on some of the ideas and concepts that we hold very dear in our heads, especially coming from a kind of business school and management tradition. And I don't want to say anything else about the inquiry. I think I will hand over immediately to Antoinette for a proper introduction of Gert.
Yeah, and you already said a lot, but I would still like to start with that when we approached you for the interview a few months ago, we were really looking for an education researcher who is bridging philosophy, ethics, and pedagogy with practice. In other words, I think this was a very demanding combination. And in German, we would call this Eierlegende Wollmilchsau. So congratulations that you are seen like that. Looking at your work, we did really think Eureka. So I would like to also formally introduce you so other people also know. Gert Biesta is professor of public education at the Maynooth University, Ireland, and at the same time, professor for educational theory and pedagogy, difficult word, and deputy head of the Institute of Education, Teaching and Leadership at the University of Edinburgh. He holds several honorary doctorates, among them one from the University of Uppsala. And that's the only one I mentioned because that's the only one I know how to pronounce. He's also a winner of the Grand Medal of the University of Ghent and multiple book awards winner. His work, and I have already said that, is really spanning areas from philosophy to education to citizenship and democracy, as well as lifelong learning. And he's also known for his very healthy criticism on the neoliberal hegemony invading education. And by the way, he engages with postmodern philosophy and manages to digest people like Levinas or Derrida in a way that non-philosophers can understand. Though it still was an intellectual challenge, I have to say. Yet you are convinced that we grow by challenges. So thank you by that and for that then. As usual, our Leaders for Humanities are also bridge builders, not only between subject areas, but also between practice and theory. And here I just would like to mention that Gert was for a long time a physics teacher, and later at the University of Exeter would also do vocational teaching. So he is not only writing about teaching, but he knows how it feels and smells, or as how it is being in the world as a teacher. And that I find as important. And with that, as usual, because I think no introduction ever can pay really tribute to somebody, I would like to give you the word. Gert, what have I missed? How would you introduce yourself?
It's a pretty good introduction. Maybe to add that I was born in the Netherlands and lived there for about 42 years and then moved to England and after that to Scotland. And it's funny, when you move to another country, then you actually gain a perspective on where you're from, mm-hmm. and you begin to see things that are different. So that was quite an important step where I realized even more that I think the continental way to do education, speak about education, is very different from the Anglo-American way. And it begins with language, but then behind language, you find history, culture, implicit assumptions. So that has been a really interesting experience to make that shift. And one way to summarize my work is that I'm still trying to explain in English what all these German thinkers are about. And you can make a career out of that, so that's pretty good.
And that's really funny, because I recall that you started a seminar by saying that you did not want to export Bildung, the German word for education, because you said the Germans had enough troubles with that, and it was better to leave them be. So I thought there's something going on. But I want to, we already in the pre-session talked about it, and I thought in the presentation that might be an interesting locating, and I'm thinking about one person we interviewed called Simon Westen, who said it's always important to locate yourself in your own work. So in it seems to be that for you, the locating of yourself as identity between pedagogy and philosopher is something that is quite important. What does that mean for you, Gert? Could you take us on that thought?
So I really like philosophy, and I like philosophical questions, philosophy as a genre. But I don't think, and this has taken me, I think, quite a while to come to that understanding, I don't think that human practices like education, that they can be understood as the application of theory. So over the years, I've become more and more convinced that in a sense, it's all in the practice. And the real challenge is to really understand what's going on in the practice, how different practices differ, what the point of these practices is. Now, when you begin to ask those questions, of course, you look for inspiration wherever you can. And from there, you can go back to philosophy. But always then to return to the practice, which in my case is education. And again, in the continental tradition, that is a very clear understanding, where pedagogique is an academic discipline that has for a long time, had a good position in university, but that doesn't exist in the Anglo-American context, where everything that's done around education, most of it is done from teacher education. Mm-hmm. So it hasn't got its own, you can say, intellectual grounding and disciplinary identity. And that's quite a difference. And therefore, the closest what I could find in the English-speaking world were people who were doing philosophy of education. And I accept that that's an institutional way of existing. But what often worries me is that when you get into a conversation, very quickly it moves from the real educational questions to whether you have sort of interpreted this or this page from Wittgenstein correctly or not. And then I think
I have those conversations, believe you me. But I think what I'm also hearing is the pragmatist. And I'm sure we're gonna come back to that. I remember Frank Martella saying pragmatist attitude is always to keep theory at arm's length. Yeah. And I think you're kind of manifesting exactly that. I think the second thing that will come back to us is freedom, because I hear a healthy dose of skepticism towards institution, which of course comes through in some of your writings, yeah. And which I've experienced in the Netherlands very often, a very strong regard for freedom. So I think I'm taking a few other things away from what you just said. Antoinette, any other questions in this section?
Yeah, well, just a remark. I find that also very interesting, because it would have never occurred to me that pedagogy is not a subject in the Anglo-American world, which is really interesting, because for me that is that in every university. But of course, if I look at Disa and Ryan, for instance, who are then heralded as pedagogy as well, they are doing just psychology in reality. So that's interesting. I'm interested in maybe one last question. I always find it interesting where you situate yourself, but also, you're talking about that as well. What were transforming events, maybe role models or people, or in your biography, I also read that you had an accident and that changed your trajectory. So if we can look a little bit beyond the facade, what would be the transforming events?
I think one was, I've always had an interest in education. Many young children want to work for the fire brigade or those kind of jobs. My first idea for a job was to become a professor of architecture, which is sometimes silly for a child to say, but it means that I've had this fascination with teaching and education for a long time. But it took me a while to get into that. And I think one really significant moment was when someone said to me, I think you can teach, do you want to do some teaching? In a context in which that was not obvious at all. And I still value that moment tremendously, because on the inside, I really wanted that, but for some reason, it couldn't come sort of out of me. And someone who recognizes and sees something in you that is not that obvious, that has been a very significant moment. I also had an accident that really nearly killed me. So, I mean, that gives you an understanding that you cannot take life for granted, and that it can be, it can end in a second. That has made me more relaxed about life. And there is something there that you could say it was quite a gift to wake up there.
Very interesting.
And yet you later turn to Hannah Arendt, who is about mortality, but anyhow, just an interesting...
The notion of gift and givenness will come back to us. And by the way, I recall one paper where you wrote about engineering of art. So even on the architectural side, I think you've redeemed yourself in the end. Yeah. Thank you very much, Gert. And again, it's wonderful to have you. Let me bring up for one second the structure, because as you can already sense, this conversation is going to be very intriguing, I hope. And by the way, I made a note. One of your essays or books starts with a quote by Yeats, who said, education is not about filling a bucket, but about lighting a fire. And I think I sense the beginnings of a fiery kind of dialogue. So I'm looking forward to it. But let me structure, or try to structure, a little bit, given that the field is so vast. So we normally, as people who follow us know, go from the question of philosophy on what is good and what is a good society towards its operationalization, and you're already challenging that linkage in regards to making operate organizations good. And from there we go to change on the notion that, okay, if we know what an organization should roughly look like, then how do we go there? And again, in this conversation, I guess you will also challenge that notion that there's some sort of ideal that we should aim for and can plan to go towards it. But in the context of your work, Gert, I think what we will try to do is, on the first part, we will try to take you, as long as you allow us, on a journey across philosophy of education, because as Antoinette mentioned, you have made us sweat, because you're the first person who is openly declaring to be very close to the post-structuralist and post-modernist, and that's of course something very intriguing for us, and we want to understand that a little bit more, and hopefully people listening will also find that very interesting. From there we want to go towards the operationalization in a certain degree. So what does all that philosophy mean in the context of a theory of education, contextualized in schools? From there, we want to move to this question of teaching education, which for us is more about leadership education. Antoinette already went there. So what's the way that others, be that teachers or leaders, can instigate that educational method or change, transformation in individuals? And once we have a good understanding of the philosophy, your theory of education, and the role of teachers, we then want to move towards democracy and civic learning. And finally, take all that and see if we can get from you some thoughts on, okay, if organizations today, businesses, have a role to play in civic education and lifelong learning, what could that possibly look like? And are there any hopes to go there? So that's going to be a little bit of scaffolding.
Yeah.
But as I think you already made clear, and the conversation at the beginning already made clear, we're probably going to break that scaffolding and deconstruct it very often. But let us try to start somewhere. And I think I recall one of your presentations where you said, don't make me talk about John Dewey because I've talked so much about it. And of course you wrote a PhD thesis on, if I recall, on John Dewey, and a master thesis on Richard Rorty. So pragmatism. Can we start maybe this philosophical journey with pragmatism? What is the role of pragmatism in educational theory from your vantage point, and what are the things that you are picking up from there?
I did delve deep into pragmatism, also because at the time when I was a student, there were these big discussions going on about objectivism, relativism, postmodernism. And those positions, in a sense, were quite sort of, antagonistic. And not many people were reading pragmatism because the consensus was, okay, we had pragmatism that was sort of an amateur kind of philosophy, and then we got proper analytic philosophy, and therefore we no longer need pragmatism. And what you could begin to see at the time, Richard Rorty was really important there, Richard Bernstein as well, who has died very recently, I saw. They were saying, wait a minute, what the pragmatists are doing is actually very close to where this whole conversation is heading. So that was an interesting moment. And then I wanted to find out more about pragmatism and focused on Dewey because, he was also known in education. Dewey has also written a lot. I need to count the pages to see who's winning, whether he has written more pages or I, but I'll do that.
And you, of course.
He has been all over the place. I mean, he didn't only do education and
democracy. He critiqued his theory of the democracy, which is, of course, one of the ones he's famous for. Yeah, where I wanted to ask, and maybe what we do is we go philosopher by philosopher. I think we've got about five, so let's see how far we go. And we throw in one question that intrigued us in regards to how you take those pieces up. Let's see if we can manage, because we had a few questions at the end, but maybe Antoinette, we can throw them in. So my question on pragmatism relates to one of the fundamentals here, which is epistemology. And I think what you're saying is postmodernism, and you already used the word. Postmodernism has been wrongly understood as the nascence of plurality, whereas you say, no, it's actually a criticism of scientific rationality. So postmodernism is an anti-movement, so to speak, to saying epistemology rules the question of what we know is the most important questions, and you will turn later, we will hear, towards actually politics and ethics is probably the first question we should ask. But I want to ask you something about truth. So that one of the problems that we've discussed with Ed Freeman, for example, is the absence of a normative core, but I parked that question. But it's also a question of what is true, where pragmatists are often criticized to say true is what works. So there's no absolute notion of truth anymore. And that, I think, comes back in your view on socialization once we go to educational theory. So how do you deal with this notion of truth? Are you convinced that the pragmatist absence of an absolute theory is justified, or how have you made sense of that in your mind?
Okay, that's that's a complex question. So let's see where I can sort of step into that. So maybe one thing to mention that I think that has really stayed with me from pragmatism is, you can say, the pragmatic attitude, where as soon as you encounter an answer, you ask, what's the question to which this answer is an answer? I think that for me is the basic lesson from pragmatism, that it all starts with questions. And if you forget that, then philosophy becomes very quickly just the taking of a position, where people say, I believe in this answer, and someone else said, I believe in that answer, and then you can fight over that. But what is forgotten is what actually was the question. I think that is really helpful, even in discussions about truth and about knowledge. That it's not simply to make a statement about objective truth exists or it doesn't exist, because in itself, those statements, you can say they are undecidable. So that for me is really important about pragmatism. The other thing I think that pragmatism did, and do we for me has developed that in most detail, is to bring the question of time into our understanding of knowledge and truth. And that is, I would say, an Aristotelian move. So you can see that in what Dewey is doing there, where in Aristotle you have this distinction between the eternal and the variable. So Aristotle says some things will never change. So if we have knowledge of that, then the knowledge will never change. But then Aristotle says most of our lives take place in this reality of the variable, where we act and our actions have consequences, but there is always surprise and openness and change. And Dewey actually takes that second idea, and he says, we only live in a world of change. And he says, as long as there are scientists or philosophers who keep believing in this idea of the eternal, they will keep producing this idea of objective truth. And Dewey says, but if we acknowledge that, yeah, we are thrown into the world, we act in the world, and those actions have consequences, and we can, gain a lot if we look carefully at what the consequences of our actions are, then we can, gain knowledge in a very different way. Where truth has meaning, but truth is always about, you can say, what we do and what we expect will happen as a result of that.
And for that me, sounds that sounds exactly. I think Gert, we will make a connection if you allow us with them, Bill Talbot, because what he describes as action logic and his ontological four dimensions of reality, I think, is very close to what you describe, and of course goes back to phronesis and the difficult the reference versus episteme that you're making as the invariable. So I think very interesting. So we are already taking there's a slant from pragmatism to a contextual truth that is experienced and validated, so to speak, through being in the moment, being in the being. Very interesting. I thanks for that. And I think what we will do, I texted Antoinette in the back. We will try to do four clusters of philosophers, because otherwise we're never going to get through it. Antoinette, do you want to take the next cluster?
No, I'm not going to do Habermas. That's not what
you don't want to take Habermas.
No, but I just wanted to say, it's also a remark. No, you can do Habermas. But I also find it interesting that we have the practice turn already, of course, in Dewey, and then now we go to the language turn. And I'm just very curious, so I let Otti do the asking, but I'm very curious because you are kind of ambivalent when it comes to Habermas. So there is kind of this, in certain ways he is more progressed, but then you still see a lot of problems with his variant of critical theory. But as I said, I let...
I think that's already a good question, right? So what's the problem with Habermas and his idealist version of communication, where almost communication becomes kind of an end in itself, and language, as Antoinette says, what do you take from there? But I would like to contextualize, because you got a very nice article where you describe critical theory and you say you can actually break it into three pieces: critical dogmatism, transcendental critique, and deconstruction. So maybe we can get your views before we go afterwards to the post-structuralist. So without going into Derrida and Levinas at this point, but maybe if you can, what is critical theory for you? And then Antoinette's point, right? So where does Habermas come in, and what's the problem? And don't blame the Germans again, because otherwise you're going to get problems with our listeners.
Yeah, gosh, what to say there. So now I think Habermas is really a fantastic thinker and really interesting. Also because at some point he does go back to the pragmatists, more to Mead than to Dewey. Mm-hmm. So there is, I think, this practical turn as well. I think that there are quite a lot of misreadings about Habermas, where people say, oh, Habermas tells us that if we just sit together and let sort of the force of the argument play itself out, then everything will be fine. And that's not how I understand Habermas in the ideal speech situation, because what he tries to do there is to articulate a criterion for communication. But that criterion needs to be in action when we are in communication and interaction. Mm-hmm. And to read Habermas as saying, and if we then can't come to an agreement, we can just jump to this other level. That's not how I understand that what Habermas is saying. So I think in that sense, he is also quite a good political thinker, actually. The only reason that he doesn't figure prominently in my work is because you cannot engage with everything. And at the time when I was a student, quite a lot of the people in my surrounding did a lot of work on Habermas already. And then there, I sort of said, well, let's go back to pragmatism and see what that has to contribute to these discussions. That then also has to do with the whole question of critique. And the paper you mentioned is actually an attempt to say, in the field of education, a lot of people talk about critical thinking and students should be critical, but what does it actually mean to be critical? And there I try to go back and say, well, to be critical can mean just to apply a criterion where you say, these are my values, and with that I can judge everything that passes. That you can say is critical dogmatism. which is fine. So there is something good about dogmatism because values matter. But there I engage, I think, most explicitly with Habermas, who says, well, it's still dogmatic, and can we find another criterion for critique? And he does that with the performative contradiction, in a sense, saying, well, as soon as someone says something, but in the saying they contradict themselves, there you can find a point. And educators have worked a lot with that as well. But a performative contradiction is always the contradiction between what you say and the conditions of possibility for saying that. And that assumes, but we're deep into philosophy now, that it's possible to have knowledge of the conditions of possibility of what we do.
Or at least a theory.
Yeah.
Right. Because I think the critical realism critique of the post-constructionist to a degree is exactly that, that they say we can still gain coherence in our theory and therefore prove that something is not coherent to the theory.
Yeah. And here for me, then Derrida came in, who actually said, well, we are always too late to go back to the conditions of what we are doing. And therefore he said this idea of transcendental critique and performative contradictions doesn't work. And out of that, Derrida then goes into, deconstruction, and that word does an awful lot. Which is
let us go there, because you already said Habermas wasn't central to you, but certainly post-structuralism or the French thinkers.
May I just take out one thing, because I think we can take it up later if ever we are reaching Heidegger. But I think you're also critiquing that this is more of an individualistic view still. So I mean, this relational ontology is not at the forefront, and I think that was another aspect.
That's a very good point, which I think also in the democracy discussion we will pick up again. Atomistic citizen is an oxymoron, and I think some of what we sensed in your almost a notion of intersubjectivity, you say, but it's almost like an interbeingness. So I think that is indeed something we can explore now, actually. Yeah. So let's go to the post-structuralist. And what I think would be interesting for us, and I think many people here, would be how do you contextualize the French thinkers? So Jacques Derrida and, French-Lithuanian, Levinas and Foucault and Jacques Rancière. What do you pick up from them? And how do you critique constructivism or constructionism at the same time? Because I think that's a really interesting piece, because half of us, we come from theories that are grounded in constructionism or cognitive development of theories from the Piagets and Ericssons and Kohlbergs and so on. So I think that is actually starting to get really close to our heart. So yeah, if you could take that up.
I think I take a pragmatic lesson from the French philosophers you mentioned, that ultimately they all try to say life comes before theory. Mm-hmm. And if we mistake life for theory, then we're no longer taking life seriously. That would be one way to read Foucault, for example, who actually shows how theories sort of interfere with life. It is how I read Derrida, who always says this ambition to go back to the foundations is an impossible ambition, because it's a theoretical gesture, but it's impossible in life. Life goes on, and we should be mindful what we're doing there. So that's not to be anti-theoretical, but almost in a pragmatic way to say, yeah, theories are answers to questions, but we ask the questions, and in function of that, of course, we can theorize. But don't think that when we do that, we can sort of jump over our own shadow or find our own foundation. So that's
so what you link to. If, sorry for being a little bit interruptive here, but you link it to this question of where are you? As in being thrown into the world already. But is there a subtle difference between a Heideggerian kind of phenomenology and the being in the world that Antoinette mentioned vis-a-vis the deconstruction in Derrida? Is there something that we should note?
Yeah, there's an awful lot there. So just to see how we can sort of highlight some points. So I think that's indeed a tradition there where Heidegger does really important things by saying we are thrown into the world and we find ourselves there, and then everything happens. And you can see Derrida as sort of radicalizing that by saying it's never possible to go back to the origin before that. We have to accept that we are in the middle of that. Heidegger then sort of moves in the direction where he says we are therefore the ones who should be open to the world and should receive the world as it comes. And there is something important about that insight, but receptivity cannot be without a criterion, I would say. And here, in a sense, we come to the question of the good. So if you sort of follow Heidegger, you should say, so our job is to be open to everything that comes. Mm-hmm. But then we know that there's also a lot of shit that comes in our direction. And the question is, so what do we do there? And there, very quickly, for me, Levinas comes in, but Hannah Arendt as well. And Levinas says, yes, we are there. We are not in control of what comes to us. But what comes to us should not just be welcomed because it comes to us. What comes to us doesn't appeal to me. So it suddenly puts me in the picture. You can say my responsibility, but I would also say suddenly you also meet your own freedom there. And for me, that's an important sort of difference from Heidegger, who struggles to really identify that moment of encountering your freedom to say yes or no to what arrives. And for me, that's a bit the journey also that I have made through these thinkers.
It's not a challenge in so Levinas. I think Antoinette, you said it. So it's the notion of the other. So there's an almost existential responsibility being summoned into the being by the face of the other, where the other doesn't necessarily need to be a person, but it's almost, in his words, it's like a revelation. So there's a notion of a almost a pre-existential ethical accountability that I encounter by being in the world. But doesn't that mean that I'm almost, the moment that I, as you say, am called into freedom, I'm giving it up because I have to sacrifice my autonomy immediately because I step into the responsibility of the other. And for me, it almost felt like you're actually avoiding the ethical argument. So you're saying there are no deontic rules or virtues in an Aristotelian tradition to decide how I step into that shit that comes to me, so to speak. So being in the world, you're deriving an existential responsibility from the mere fact that I'm only in presence of the other, as Antoinette says, kind of becoming, so being the nativity. But is that not a, are we not creating an circle where actually I still don't have any criterion what that means in the shit is coming into my face?
I think that's true. So it doesn't give you a criterion, but it gives you a very different way to think about yourself. Mm-hmm. So I have a particular reading of laziness that not everyone agrees with, but I think too many readings of laziness are moralizing or even sentimental, where they say, oh, I have to be responsible for the other. And yeah, to me, that sounds very sentimental. And in a sense, it misses the point. I come back to a sentence from Sigmund Bauman, who summarizes laziness by saying, responsibility is the first reality of the self. And that for me is the key message in laziness, where he says, I'm not telling people that they should be responsible. I'm trying to figure out in what kind of situation we as human beings suddenly realize that I am I, and that I have freedom of action. And for me, that's also a very important educational question, where and how that moment arrives. And I would say ethics, moral philosophy comes after that, because those are all attempts to help each other to deal with that moment where you suddenly realize I have freedom to act. I can say yes or no here. And that puts a burden on me. And then you can say, can we help each other to do that well? But ethics never comes sort of before that, and it can never tell us what to do. But yeah, for me, that's the significant point there. And that for me, in a sense, is post-structural, because it says it doesn't begin with the structure that we know and where we are, and then we start doing things. The moment where I arrive in my own life, you could almost say, that's where everything starts. And that has not, there is no ontology to tell about that. That's a pure existential moment.
Well, but you also say, maybe we talk about that later, that you can avoid that. I mean, you can immunize yourself against that. That's the one way. Or the other way is to use power and just make sure that the other then responds in the way you want the other to respond. And so then you come with education and kind of says, well, we have to open that space that people go into this vulnerability, because this is also a vulnerability, at least if I read Levinas correctly. It's and that's very ambiguous vulnerability. So somewhere an ethical argument before, at least for the teacher, would come up here.
So I think you're right. This is really important for education. Because if this helps to understand how, subjects arrive in the world, then the question is, have we got anything to do there as educators? And I think from what you just said, you also indicate what can go wrong there. So if we think as educators that we can tell children, young people, what they should do with their freedom, then we have already destroyed that freedom. If we just say education is an impossible project, it's an ambition we should no longer have because it's always power and it's always limiting freedom, then we simply say, well, so children should face the world immediately and then they should figure it out. And I think that's also educationally not very responsible. So for me, these insights help to figure out what it means to be an educator in relation to, there are all kinds of phrases for it. One I also like is the arrival of the I of other human beings.
It remains very difficult and therefore super exciting, right? Because we are not solving, which I guess is part of the idea, education isn't solving anything. We are holding a constant question and I think you frame it as irritation of how to situate yourselves. And there's also an underlying question of freedom versus ethics, I think, where I'm very hesitant myself to take freedom as ethics. I think that's a simplification, because the call to responsibility that you describe contain limits my freedom, even if I limit my freedom, right? But what you call this kind of non-egological living, not at the center, that is a voluntary maybe, but that is a limitation of my freedom. So there's an ethic that is underlying that limitation that I do of my freedom in a grown-up fashion. And that is, to a degree, the next step to say, well, authority might destroy my freedom. I think that is indeed a good question to ask, and we're going to come back to that in your educational theory. But I think it's all, I mean, super interesting. Antoinette, do you want to close this section of the philosophy so that we can bring Gert, as I know he wants, to the pedagogy part of the conversation?
Yeah, I think I mean, the question about good is something we wanted to bring in here as well. We started now with that, thanks to Gert, because he was leading the conversation nicely, which is really good. And I think I just would like to go back also to Hannah Arendt, because that's the other philosopher you often draw on, and kind of make the implication that the human life, the active life, is the good life. So why is that good? For whom is that good? And then I shouldn't make my questions always so complicated. I have the next follow-up question. I wait till you answer.
So yes, I turn to Arendt quite a lot. I had a lovely session with colleagues in Denmark last week, which was all built around talking about our favorite Arendt quotes, which was lovely to do. And I just in preparing realized, yeah, that some of these quotes are really central to my thinking. I think what I take from Arendt is that the how shall I put it, the life with others is inevitable. So there is no alternative. Life doesn't exist if it's in isolation. So if it's in isolation, you have survival or biological processes, but human life, and she does that under the heading of action, is to say, yeah, that's to exist with others. And that's not a theoretical choice, but again, that's our existential condition. And Arendt, in nuanced but also very clever ways, says it's of course always tempting to want to be in control of other people. But as soon as we act on that, we begin to undermine the possibility for other people to be beginners, as she puts it. And one of the favorite quotes I have, plurality is the condition of human action. That's a deep insight, where she says, yeah, if I want to bring my beginnings into the world, I have to understand that other people are doing that as well, and that other people take up my beginnings in all kind of other ways. But that is what it means to live in the world, which you can say is to step into the social fabric, or how you want to call that. And that's difficult, because many of our inclinations, wherever they come from, go in the opposite direction.
So I mean, another thing she's of course saying, there we have the unpredictability of action again. You have been talking a lot about we feel insecure and fragile. It could be that the darkness of the human heart is an important aspect, so she's not naive and kind of saying it's always going into one direction. But what I then found interesting, maybe that's just a footnote in her work, but I found it really interesting that she said what we then need are two faculties. So she talks about the faculty of forgiving and the faculty of promising. which is a little bit different, of course, from what Levinas is doing. And I was just kind of wondering, have you tumbled upon that? Do you do something with that? Because for me as a trust researcher, that's of course a very interesting insight she has there.
I haven't explored it sort of theoretically in reading through Arendt, but I very often refer to trust as a really important sort of educational gesture. That as soon as you say to a student, you first need to give me proof that I can trust you, then nothing will happen. The whole point of trust is that you take the risk of saying, I trust you. And then for the student to step into to that trust. And yeah, there is sort of something really important educationally there. And I think that a lot of what happens in education systems, but also in societal systems, is constantly to try to replace trust with something else. But that destroys the education, and probably it will destroy some other things in society as well. But trust is, of course, risky because you open the door and,
I come back to risk, but I think there's also in the, there's almost an institutional aspect, which again, I think you're writing critically about institutions to a degree, and we're going to come to that. But when you speak about democracy, there's the aspect in the public space to transform my individual needs into collective needs. And that almost sounds like an institutionalization, so to speak, and some community, as you say, community as practice of that responsibility principle. I think what Antoinette points to is if this notion of promise is intrinsic in the action, and action is, as you say, preconditioned on plurality, then in the context of business, where of course we are producing, right, there's almost like a question of, okay, what's the institutionalization of that promise? And the promise that maybe has two aspects, as you describe later, between poiesis and praxis. But I guess we're going to come to that. But I think it's just interesting that underneath that very simple statement that we are in the world together, and that, as Antoinette says, active life somehow is life, out of that condition already arise a number of consequences that we need to be aware of. And that's if we have a view of, again, to Antoinette's point, that we don't want another Auschwitz, as you say. There is a learning away from somehow. We need to think about how do we bring that into our institutions? How do we bring that into the world? And again, civic education we're going to come to. But I think, again, super interesting. Do we want to briefly crunch up any insights before we go into the next section, which is educational theory? Is there any pieces from this first 40 minutes that stand out? Antoinette, anything that you want to throw in, and then we're going to come to Gert.
I always have to do the difficult tasks here. I just have to say I'm very intrigued by this, which we later you call subjectification, by this coming into the world, by allowing the unique voice to come up, and what the conditions are for this to arise, and how we can and should is of course the difficult word here, step into that encounter. And I think this is really, really important, because I don't see that happening. I only see it happening with the authenticity discussion, and that is exactly what it's not all about, because it's about also in the world. So it's the coming or becoming into the world. So the world aspect is very important. I hope we take that up later again. And I just find it very important, because in organizations we are, I think, completely immunized. We categorize, we are very seldom dropping our masks. We are not seen as unique individuals. In that sense, I just want to take that to the next section.
I take two things. I think one, I'm still crying because you dismantled my belief in constructivism, in as much as I think some of the theories that we hold dear in regards to identity formation, in this this post-structuralist perspective have to be queried, and we're going to come to that with your lovely robot vacuum cleaner metaphor in a second, but this idea that I'm at the center of my meaning making, and therefore the reality is in my mind, and if I increase my consciousness and understanding of my own paradigms, that's the key to agency and self-development that you are contesting. Secondly, I'm crying because you put a big footnote in one of your papers where you mention, I'm not a big fan of Aristotelian theory in the way that they are being used for virtue formation, which is another one we're actually going to speak to one of the most renowned experts in military ethics and character formation at West Point very shortly. So again, I think you're casting doubt on whether
we could talk with him about Derrida, but I don't think that's very
I think we should bring in Derrida and say, what are you saying? And we're gonna come back to you again a second time. But so you're casting doubt on some of the theories that we are actually building on and integrating, and that will create us trouble. But I think beautifully, I'm with Antoinette here to a degree, is you're throwing up that question of the anthropological question of what does it mean to be truly human again. And I think that's a really important question that we maybe have forgotten, and it links to your strong argument to say the purpose of education, we've forgotten that question, and it links, I think, very strongly to Antoinette's point of this becoming fully human, being becoming into presence. So I think that's you disturbed us in a positive way, as Antoinette said in the introduction. But maybe get a closure of the what is good, what is philosophy, anything that you want to flag before we move to the theory.
So I know that in everything I've said in response to your questions, for me there is always an educational angle in the background. So if sometimes maybe I jump too quickly from one philosopher to another, or don't really get into the philosophical argument, it is because I'm pursuing educational questions, and they are, I know where they are, and maybe they are still a bit implicit, but we can make that more explicit. But for me, it always means that at the end of the day, I'm not interested in philosophical position, but I'm interested in sort of the educational argument. And while you touch upon something really important, that how can I say it without causing more tears? I think constructivism is ultimately, this is quite a heavy word, it's an infantile fantasy, let's put it like that. That's very strong, but it still relies on the idea that I come before the world. And maybe that's true. I think with many of these things, they're undecidable. So we have to ask, when is this a good idea? And when doesn't it make sense? And for me, it doesn't make sense as an anthropology. It doesn't make sense for me as a way to understand what my life is or what should matter in my life. So we need to frame these things and not simply say that that's nonsense and that isn't nonsense. But
I think now then, we want to take you up on this, because I mean, it's easy it's easy to critique. And I think sometimes the critical theorists have forgotten about the emancipation part of their own movement. Right. So, and I think even in the 2020 book on the obstinate education, you to a degree contend at the end to say, we still need to figure out what the alternative to constructivism is. If that doesn't work, then what? And I think, so let's go into that second part about what is your theory of education? What is education? What's the problem with modern education? How does it work? Etc. So I think, Antoinette, do you want to start us off into this?
Well, I also want to put just one footnote up. Maybe we don't have time to take it up. Of course, we were also reading your lifelong learning. And here I sometimes had a hard time to find how different it really is from something like Etienne Wenger's constructionist, but we're not going there. But I mean, I didn't see it always that disparate like we are now having it in the first part. Mm. And that's another topic, because now we want to go to education. So I'm getting back to the question. And I think here the first question would be certainly you always distinguish between education, Bildung, learning. So maybe we just start with kind of making sense of this, why you do these different categories up, why you open it up and how you open it up.
I'm again thinking what's sort of a quick way to get into this. For me, education is a practice, and it centers on what educators do. Mm-hmm. And you can say that that's a practical way in, where you simply say, yeah, as human beings, we find ourselves in situations where we teach, where we educate. And when you look at those situations, there are always encounters between generations, between newcomers and old timers, where sort of the old timers or the existing generation in some way is doing something with the new generation. That for me is what education is about. And therefore, a lot of talk about learning doesn't speak to that, because we can come back to, because there are problems with learning as well, but you can say, yeah, human beings are learning organisms, but that's fine. And I would even say, in such an understanding, learning is going on all the time. And therefore, if you want to understand education, learning is actually not a helpful notion, because education is intentional, purposeful action by educators. Now, that raises all kinds of questions. Why is it there? Is it needed? How can it be justified? What does it look like? What are the dangers of doing that? But for me, those are the proper educational questions. And then what frustrates me in English is that, in a sense, there is only this word education. What I like about German is that you have a number of different words, Bildung, Erziehung, Ausbildung, which at least highlights that there are differences that matter. And very quickly, I would say Bildung is very much about how, as human beings in interaction with culture mediated by other human beings, we become cultivated and culturated. So we become speakers of language, practices, practitioners of practices. We become members of traditions. We become part of communities of values. All that you can say are processes of building. But for me, Erziehung is something different, because that is always the moment when an educator arrives on the scene to do something. And then there is the question, what do educators do? As I said, how can that be justified? How does it matter? And just to say, the role of the teacher is to facilitate learning, for me, doesn't touch upon what educational dynamics and educational relationships are. And that's partly because I think learning is a very, it's a process term. So my quick way is always to say, to become a good criminal, you need to learn as well. So we cannot simply say the school is a place for learning, because we do care about the learning that goes on. We also know that many students learn horrible lessons in schools, for example, that they are not worthy, or that they are stupid, or that they are not the right kind of person. So all that shows why learning is very unhelpful as a language for education.
Maybe if I go in here yet, because I think these nuances that you describe, you're bringing into your own framework. And I think you haven't yet introduced it, but I think it's actually in the English language, so to speak, quite helpful, because you're talking about qualification in regards to attaining skills and competencies, and then socialization, which I think relates very much to what you explained about building this cultural and traditional and historical situating, and then subjectification. And I think, as Antoinette already pointed out at the beginning, so this becoming subject, the living idea of coming into presence, of course, is what is behind your subjectification part of the conundrum. And we've gone through many of your critiques of learnification. And I think Antoinette and I have been discussing this whole notion of evidence-based research and evidence-based new public management and so on. So we're fully on your side with regards to this McDonaldization of the process of education. But I want to kick, and I love your idea of the paradigm of shopping. We're going to come to that in the democracy section. But can I... So if we all agree, there are certain aspects which almost become like a production, and the student is being produced, and kind of we're fooling ourselves by creating measures that actually don't measure the right thing. And I think you're to a degree, and maybe we will challenge that a little bit, but you're jumping to subjectification, i.e. Erziehung as the core of the education. Now, what then would you define is the purpose of education? Because as you say yourself, the first question is, what do we educate for?
So one way in which I've formulated that is to say to arouse a desire in another human being to exist in the world in a grown-up way. And that has this idea of existing. It has the idea of that existence can only happen in the world. It has this quality of grown-upness, which very quickly means that you can never take your own desires as a criterion for your life. Because if you really try to exist in the world, you will meet A, other people who have their desires, and B, you meet a world that puts limitations on our desires, the whole ecological crisis, for example. So to try to exist in a grown-up way is to always be in a relationship with your desires rather than be driven by your desires. And then I say, what can we do as educators? We cannot produce that way of existing, but what we can try to do is to arouse a desire in the new generation to want to exist in that strange way. I call it an eccentric way, in the literal sense of to exist outside of yourself as center of the universe. So that would be the most precise way when you ask, what do I see as sort of the purpose of the work of the educator, is to work on that. Now, that doesn't mean that I'm saying knowledge doesn't matter or skills are trivial. On the contrary, but it's a question of priority. So what always irritates me is when politicians or researchers say, actually, knowledge and skills is the only thing that matters. And if we measure that, then we can push our country to the top of the league table. That's not taking knowledge and skills actually seriously.
I think what we will come to degree to is this, building on McIntyre and his work on after virtues to degree, is this notion that actually both the qualification and the socializations are part of subjectification, or it's a being in all of that. And for us, of course, phronesis is the answer to degree. You're not using phronesis there. You're using it more in regards to the teacher, so practical wisdom. But I think the question is, can I ask a facetious question before Antoinette? I think you want to ask, because I'm handing over to Antoinette, but a facetious question yet. So you've been in this for decades. So would you consider yourself grown up then?
No, but that's So that's a difficulty with the word. So to try to exist in a grown-up way means that you always carry some doubt about your desires. And when that doubt disappears, then you're lost. Then you've handed over your subjectness to other forces. So that for me would be the best sign of taking this question of grown-upness seriously, that you carry a doubt about your desires, even a doubt about the desire to be someone. German scholar Klaus Mollenhauer beautifully says, what education should aim for with everyone is a degree of what he calls Selbstungewissheit. He says it becomes dangerous when people are 100% certain of themselves. Mm. So to keep even a small degree of uncertainty about yourself, that's really important. And for me, that's to try to exist in a grown-up way.
Which reminds me of Luigino Bruni and a conversation about charism. He said the moment that we identify with our own charism, with our own, what we stand for, with our idol, so to speak, we become ideological. And we are lost. So we need to hold that little gap towards what we want to become always very dear. Otherwise, we are lost. Antoinette.
It reminds me also of this question that we always have to examine our lives. So, I mean, we're almost a little bit back to the Greeks, but we're not doing that. I'm more interested in how you practically enable that. And I found two things we could dive in, and I'm interested in both. First of all, you have this pedagogy of mm-hmm. interruption. So here I just would like to have some examples. I can understand there is not a clear way to do it. That, of course, would be the opposite of the exercise. But still, how do you enable that? And the other thing is, of course, your project on narrative learning, the life learning, where it's also about achieving agency. I mean, they're both aspects where we could also have a look at how is that facilitated, what the educator then would do, as you always say.
So it is true that there are sort of no recipes here. And again, this is an important aspect of how to understand teaching. So I'd like this idea of the artistry of teaching, where you say teachers constantly need to create practice, and that happens in the moment. And if you think you just run a pre-programmed script, then you're not teaching. But to really be able to create education in the moment, you need to have signposts, you need to have orientation, and that's what theory can do. It can give you questions and ability to see and perceive and be sensitive. So in terms of interruption, I think if as a teacher you understand that there is a particular kind of interruption that's really important, namely those interruptions that help students to disconnect from their desires, to come into a relationship with their desires, mm-hmm. or the moments that help students, you can say, to disconnect from looking for the certainty about themselves. So if you get as a teacher that that's important, then you look for opportunities in your practice to do something with those interruptions. And I don't write a lot about my own teaching, but I recently wrote a paper in which I sort of disclose some of my own things that I do there. One is an interesting program I developed with colleagues in higher education, where we took out all assessment. And it was really interesting because one thing it interrupted was the security that the assessment gives to students. So the students were quite concerned, where they said, are you not going to judge us or tell us when we have done it right? We said, no, And that's precisely an you can say a little interruption, where suddenly this whole question of who is actually the judge of my action becomes a real question, but where it also became very visible how we've created education systems where everyone has become addicted to assessment. And that addiction takes a degree of responsibility away, actually. So that's one example. I do it in other ways as well, by not giving my students choice. And choice is again something, which many people think is desirable. Students should have a choice what they do. And if you interrupt that, then suddenly you also interrupt a particular desire. So that it becomes possible to say, now, when is choice a good thing to desire, and when is it actually an uneducational or even a problematic thing? So these interruptions can do these kind of things, but you really have to invent it in the moment of your teacherly practice.
I think that we will be reading your paper, that's for sure. We won't have the time to deep dive into this enough, I think, but Antoinette and I guess we're really intrigued by this, because of course we're coming from a slightly different tradition here, right? On the one hand, we've read your paper where you compare Giddens and Taylor, for example, and this whole idea of identity as process in this web of interlocutors, whatever he calls it, this relational web, right? That seems to be an aspect that goes very close to that moral responsibility that you described earlier. Whereas the interruption of my desire, that seems to be a different lens in regards to, we're almost going to psychoanalysis. So what are my desires and why? Then what is my stance vis-a-vis others? And I think when you talk about living us in the context of this almost religious concept of revelation, that's another angle, that's a transcendental angle towards what Antoinette and I would call the common good, right? So there's a question of what is meaning, what is significance of our lives, which transcends a relational ontology, so to speak, or relational responsibility. So I think there are multiple angles that somehow come into this picture. And what it reminds me of course, is being a system psychodynamics coach. What we do in coaching is very often similar to what you described. We're holding the space for reflection. We're not necessarily introducing interruption, because it's more the vicarious listener stance that is being, we're projecting back to the person, so to speak, what is happening inside and helping with that sense making. But, and I shouldn't use sense making anymore given it's constructivist, but it could be emotional sense making as well. But I think again, it would be really interesting to understand between knowledge, again, episteme, and between disruption of identity, but also the for good. Why are we here? What is the meaning? What's the telos of us being in community? I think that there almost have to be a number of, I don't know, it's kind of different types of interruptions. Would you agree?
Yeah. So I think there's quite a lot there. It has something to do with interruption of identity, interruption of desire. And that's connected again to grown-upness. So to exist in the grown-up way means that you're not striving for pure identity, that you're not taking your desires as they arrive as the criterion for the good. And it goes back, I think, to Arendt's motive that, when we exist in the world, we are there together. And there are two options. Either we destroy everyone else so that we can have a happy time, although we then realize that there are no coffee shops open any longer. or we engage with this predicament. That's why I keep coming back to this word subject. That comes straight from Arendt, who says we're subject in the twofold sense of the word. We are subject of our actions, but we are subjected to what others do with the initiatives we take. And to take that condition seriously, and that's really difficult. Yeah, that's the grown-up way of trying to exist. And then you
Without, because you're depriving us of the criterion. And I mean, it's almost like the assumption that if we think hard enough or feel hard enough into this conundrum that you described, this solution will come up. But again, I would of course say, well, but we don't want another Auschwitz. And arguably, I mean, there's one reading which I think you're suggesting, which is the ideal of humanity triggered people to do these bad things. I could equally say, actually, they ignored the ideal of humanity and went with their own sense, with their own interpretation of how they should interact, and that led to a very bad outcome. And here, again, I think that the absence of a criterion, and this is where I got confused by the trace of God, because, I mean, bringing in Deus Ex Machina at the last minute and say, well, if it doesn't come to you, here's God, that for me doesn't work.
No, but that's... sorry to use the word again, but that's a very infantile way to think about God, to think that God is sort of the guy who can sort
of... I've been trying the whole night.
So it also has something to do with I think, religious grown-upness. And there is this fantasy of God as the one who can be blamed for everything or who can ultimately resolve everything. That's an infantile fantasy, say... At the end of the day, I have nothing to do here. I'll go to my parent or to my teacher or to the police, and they will sort it out. That's not taking your existence seriously. And then you can do two things. So you can say, so religion is an infantile fantasy and let's get rid of it. Or you can say, what has religion to say that actually speaks to our grown-upness? That's more the motive that I explore in my work. For example, by saying, here the notion of revelation comes in, and then the notion of teaching, and then maybe we want to go to leadership as well. Revelation is something that happens to me. I don't construct that. I'm not in control of that. Someone speaks to me. And I think revelation, when you begin to see it in that way, is the most everyday experience we encounter as human beings. Constantly things happen to us that are not made by us and not in our control. That's the human condition. And we can say that's irritating because I was on such a brilliant journey and suddenly that's interrupted. Or you can say, oh, maybe that's the point of life, and maybe there is something here for me to pay attention to. And I take the second approach. And again, sort of the big gesture behind my work is to say, can we take our human condition, our existing as human beings seriously? What does that take? And there are many ideas that get in the way of that, and I'm looking for the ideas that I think are helpful.
I think the challenge I have, and you've given us a lot to think about again, and I, of course I'm joking, I won't be crying, but I think for me the challenge is, again, it's almost sounding like bringing metaphysics back into pragmatism. And that's a conversation we had with Frank Matila some time ago, and kind of we had some tension there. But I think let's take your cue, Antoinette. Shall we go to, unless you want to have another question on the theory of education, do you want to go to teaching, and maybe in the context of teaching, also leadership?
Yeah, in a second. Yeah, just one remark, and you can leave it there or take it apart, and then I go to teaching and leadership. But I mean, for me, what Otti was saying with Auschwitz, I think the whole point about what Levinas and Arendt are saying is, well, in a sense, there is always risk in going into these beginnings, in going into these vulnerabilities. So, I mean, of course, somebody could take advantage of me. That's the whole point. But by engaging in these, you, of course, see the other as well, and you are growing as well. And that is probably the better prevention than kind of saying, well, we have this knowledge and everybody has this knowledge, if I understand that correctly, it's another way. And the risk as an economist, I would say, is even more diversified in this sense. Mm. But I mean, that's just maybe very outside-ish remark here.
But I think you're right that these predicaments cannot be resolved, not by sort of going to theory or values, and also not by going to authority. And that's, I think, also the lesson from Auschwitz and many other similar disasters. That as soon as you think the difficulty of human existence can be resolved in some way, either by having the strong leader or by having the right theory or the true knowledge, then it becomes dangerous. And I think, yeah, many of the thinkers I go to always try to make that point. And I always try to say, no, we have to take the difficulty of our human existence seriously, not because there is some kind of agenda or a super value, but that's where we find ourselves. And if we, yeah, draw any lessons from history, we can see where it goes wrong.
I think the challenge is it's not black and white. I think, as Arendt is also suggesting, freedom and authority can actually co-live, and education and politics can co-live. And I think there's a question of, so is every rule bad? Maybe not, right? So there's a 10 commandments had a place. Of course, for the people who are divinely sparked and understand religion as an embodied way of living, they don't need 10 commandments. But for all the others, that might be a good enough starting point to just avoid some harm that otherwise might be done, right? And I think the question to a degree is, where do you find the balance? You don't want rules that contain that subjectification that you mentioned. By the same token, there might be history, kind of heritage and tradition and rules that allow for what Antoinette describes, which is that being in community and growing in community. So I think the question is, and I think this is what you say, this question has to remain open. The moment that you close that question, you're at the risk of going down the benign dictatorship route. So that question has to be one that is open, which brings us, I think, back to Habermas to a degree and say, okay, what's the dialogue that we need to entertain? But I think, shall we go to teaching? Because I think that we are interested in leadership, and for kind of for us, this was almost like the teachers are the leaders in the context of school. Of course, what I should have said at the beginning, in the organizational world, we speak about L&D, learning and development, whereas the learning really sounds very close to your kind of qualification, whereas the development is about subjectification. And indeed, one of our good friends, Brian Angert, always said, learning is about knowledge, development is about letting go. And I think this letting go resonates very nicely with what you describe of this non-egologic way of being in the world. So hence the teacher enabling the subjectification and the leader enabling the development, for us is a very close parallel. So maybe Antoinette, do you want to kick us off into teaching and leading?
Well, I mean, as you already now implied, the teacher then becomes a very important figure, or let's say has a high responsibility, a huge responsibility. You even talk about authority sometimes. And then, of course, you have contributed quite a lot in thinking about how can I help teachers to grow into that role. You have basically done your own interpretation of Aristotle, as you will say, but it is, of course, for me, quite Aristotelian. So you look at practical wisdom, so maybe that's the first thing you can explain. And then you look at virtues. And I think here you would usually have your problems, and then you talk about virtuosity. Whereas with all what I read in your papers, I just give you some things you said. You talk about empathy, compassion, even authority. I'm not so sure that you're not also talking about formation of or habituation of virtues in reality. Just don't want to use it. But anyway, that was a lot, probably.
That's well spotted. So I try to stay away from particular traditions of character education, which I see emerging and circulating in education has very conservative educational agendas. Mm-hmm. And that really worries me. And therefore, yeah, I need to make a distinction there as well, because there is character education that just says these are the desirable character traits and how can we get there? And then, yeah, you are looking for effective interventions. And immediately I think that the subject falls out of the picture again. So that's why I'm very careful in operating there. And I look partly for different language. So the question how we hold ourselves in our existence is another way to put that, and you can also read that in quite Aristotelian way, that it's about finding a way not just to exist but also to hold yourself in that existence. But then to go sort of to the question of the teacher, I also like the idea of practical wisdom there, which again pushes back against an idea that keeps coming back again and again about teaching, that teaching is a technical activity for which you need technical knowledge or techne, or in the Aristotelian sense. And some people then push that very much towards saying, yeah, with a lot of evidence, we can tell teachers exactly what they need to do, what kind of intervention. And then I never deny that there is a really big craft dimension to teaching. Mm-hmm. You need to know how to do it, and that grows over the years. But you always need to have a sense of why you're doing it, what is desirable to do. So all these ideas of teachers who have these fantastic toolkits, the real question is, which tool do you take out of the box to use in this situation, and with what kind of purpose and intention? And for that you need a wisdom that I think is educational. So that's I think part of what sits there. And for me, yeah, I go back to Aristotle because I find it helpful both to take the sort of the craft, the how dimension seriously, but also to say that's not enough for good education.
Yeah, if I can come in, Gert, because we're doing the same, and we should send you our slides, because we're kind of saying an organizing consists of poiesis, whatever the organization is trying to craft, and therefore craftsmanship plays a role, and praxis, which is about the human flourishing and, in your words, subjectification. Now, the question, of course, is how do you form leaders / teachers in order to hold that process? And I was getting very excited in one of your papers where you started to say, here's a spiral curriculum. So I was jumping to the back and said, where's the picture? Where can I take it? Because we're developing kind of ideas about leadership development, leadership training. And there was no such picture. So I want to ask you, one, have your thoughts on the spiral curriculum advanced? Is there something you could share with us or teach us about? The other thing that I wanted to throw in again, because you said it earlier, but I think it's important here again in the context of what is the role of the teacher, because I quote you, teaching ultimately come not from the relationship with the teacher, but an encounter with something. Actually, I think this is someone writing about you, apologies, it's not quoting you, but an encounter with something akin to the mysterious God of the Bible, as opposed to the rational God of philosophy, I thought you would like that, and experienced as the revelation of that which absolutely transcends philosophical thought. So again, it's almost like enabling, which brings me to that wonderful religious priest in the United States, Bill Sloan Coffin, who once suggested that the most effective way of transforming is bearing witness, the hermeneutics of testimony. So, and I think your examples of narrative and biographic learning go a little bit there. So I wonder, to what degree do teachers need to experience that revelation before they can actually take someone on the journey towards it, because they have witnessed it in themselves? right? And again, in the context of that spiral curriculum, mm-hmm. development, how can we foster that? What are your insights?
Yeah. So the spiral curriculum is an idea from Jerome Bruner, who says any topic can be taught at an intellectually honest way at any stage in a child's development. And I really like this idea of intellectual honesty, because there are a lot of views of education that actually are dishonest, where you say, well, we begin with telling children sort of half of the truth, and then later we'll paint the whole picture. And Bruno says that's not right. The whole thing has to be on the table in its integrity. And what we need to do is to deepen and broaden how we engage with that, our understanding, our mastery, our skillfulness. That's the idea of the curriculum as a spiral rather than sort of an incremental process. And I find that, again, a very helpful way to think about the curriculum and the dynamics of education. For the teacher, this keeps intriguing me for all kinds of reasons. So I think teachers are really important for education. So without teachers, there's no education. There will be learning and building. So then the question is, so what is the teacher doing there? And one idea that I find, again, very helpful here, comes from a German scholar, Klaus Pranger, who says, if we want to get an answer to that question, we need to look at the form of teaching. Not at the values or the ideas, but it starts with the form. And then he says, what's the basic form of teaching? That is, in German, zeigen, which is both, you can say, pointing and showing. And that is helpful because immediately you see that for education, there are always three in the room. There is the teacher, the student, and something. And what teachers do is, in a sense, nothing more than saying to the student, pay attention to that something, which can be a textbook, which can be a piece of clay, which can be the world, which can be history. And in that gesture of pointing, you're not just saying, there is your task, but you're also saying, there is your task. So in the pointing, you do two things at the same time. You try to focus the attention of the student to the world, you could say. But you also hope that the world speaks to the student. And that's the Levinasian moment where you say, ultimately, as teachers, you hope that the students will meet a question. So the interesting thing of the teacher is that they stand in this triadic relationship, and that ultimately they need to leave the scene. So at some point, the student and the world will have to do it. And what you keep doing as a teacher basically is constantly turning the student back to the world. Now, some students get that, but a lot of students constantly look back to the teacher and say, but what do you actually want from me? If you step into that as a teacher, you always end up in problems of authority. Because then you say, well, actually, I want something from you, and I'm going to judge you whether you've done that well. Well, and then there is no longer freedom for the student, but also there is no freedom for the teacher, because the teacher then is caught in an authority position.
Mm-hmm. So this and takes over the accountability for the learning.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It says that I'm becoming accountable for the fact that you learn or not, which of course is again counterproductive, right?
Yeah. So this very simple idea of saying there's a triadic relationship, and what the basic form of teaching is this pointing, which is both a showing to say there is something here, but it's also an appeal to the student to say, you pay attention. Mm-hmm. It's not for me, but it's for you. I find that the most helpful way to get a sense of the work of the teacher, that also addresses all these questions of authority and relationships and power. Because ultimately, if there's any authority, it has to come from the thing, from the world, mm-hmm. from the history curriculum. Mm-hmm. There is the authority, and if the teacher...
Which almost then, if it, and you describe from symbol sense to world sense, so there's this notion of creating that linkage, which I think goes back to the identity formation as being in a web of interlocutors, so to speak, so the process of relating myself is, I think... So I just wonder, because I think you mentioned in terms of the debate about teachers, are there sage on the stage, are there guide on the side, and then you say... or even the peer at the rear, I think in this sense, then they are, that is the wrong question, right? Because they are not the focal point of attention. They are the moving my attention towards something else, and that something else becomes important, right? So it's interesting to think in a metaphor.
Yeah, that's the idea that ultimately, I use this phrase of world-centered education to say it's silly to think that the center should be the student or that it should be the curriculum or how the teacher represents the curriculum.
Yeah, I think we are very short on time, so I guess we... Yeah. And let me ask it, and our apologies because we're always getting too excited about these topics. Do we have a very hard stop, or can we run over by a few minutes? What's your...
I can run over. I'm fine. I have my next meeting in half an hour, so...
Wonderful. Then, I apologize, but I want to pick you up on your very kind kind of... I wouldn't call it offer because we called it out, but... because I think we have a few more questions. We want to go towards the democracy piece mm-hmm. and civil education to then square the circle with the organizational development that we are after. But I think one thing that I cannot forget, because people should read your paper, is robot vacuum cleaners. So in this context of the teacher and the student, what is this metaphor of the robot vacuum cleaner about, if you want to throw that in for people to read it up?
So this goes back to learning theory and also constructivist learning theory that says human beings are intelligent, adaptive systems. So we interact with our environment, and there sometimes this interaction goes smoothly, but not always. And if we encounter some kind of blockage, then we need to adjust our habits so that the transaction goes smoothly again. This basically is the philosophy of John Dewey as well. And then, there was also a whole story behind it of someone who worked in the learning sciences and heard me talking about sort of criticizing learning. And he said, but what's the problem? Because aren't we intelligent adaptive systems? And it's the whole point that we create learning environments in which children can develop their whole set of skills and understandings and habits as well. And then I was thinking, so what's the best example of that? And that's the robot vacuum cleaner, which is an intelligent adaptive machine. You put it in a room and it begins to move. And then suddenly there is a chair in the room or a plant, and it bumps into it the first time. And the second time it moves around. If that is the image of education, and it fits perfectly in saying, yes, we facilitate learning by creating learning environments and we put our students into that, there is something hugely missing. And I call that these intelligent adaptive systems, one thing they cannot do, they cannot say no. They cannot refuse to hover the carpet in Hitler's office. And there, I think the whole idea that we can understand education and even our humanity by saying we are intelligent adaptive organisms breaks down. Because what you take out of the equation is either human freedom, but that freedom is crucial at the moment where we refuse, where we say, no, I'm not going to adapt to this environment. And there, I use that in order to show that it's such a problematic and inhuman way to think about human.
And very the nice, other, yeah. Which links us, which is almost like your concept of transclusion. So I think we're going to use that as a means towards moving to the next section.
Mm-hmm. And yeah, I so would then say the. Can I just?
Of give course, one go thing? Ahead, Gert.
So the interesting thing is that robot vacuum cleaners can learn, but they cannot be taught. They cannot receive a teaching. And that is why teaching is even more important. I somewhere claim that there is only one philosophical claim in all my writings, and that's the claim that the human being is a human being who can be taught. And that's unique about us. We can learn as much as animals and artificial intelligence can learn. But I think what distinguishes us is that we can be taught or receive a teaching. We can be spoken to, addressed. And therefore, teaching has a much bigger significance than just to say, oh, that's the job that some people in schools do. I think it goes to the heart of the mystry of what it means to be. Sorry, I couldn't resist that. But
no, it's also, it's I think it's immensely important if we then look to the difference of artificial intelligence again. So, I mean, I think that could be quite another route we could go down. But I think we have...
Also, I think, absolutely, if I can, also this authenticity, right? I sense an intrinsic tension, because to a degree, if I'm subjective and I take accountability and I become authentic, so everything is about expressing myself, I could become that vacuum cleaner, because in reality, what I'm not doing is I'm using Antoinette's word, I'm immunizing myself from being taught, because being taught is containing my freedom, right? If I have, so there's almost like the teachers don't want to teach because that's undue control over the freedom. I don't want to listen because my freedom is at the center. So this whole, neoliberal cherishing of freedom, there's an intrinsic immorality that becomes a huge problem.
Yeah, that's the immunization. You can say that the robot vacuum cleaner is structurally immune. And as human beings, we can choose to be immune. Yeah. And there again, I think the biggest problems of our time go exactly there. And then to say our job as educators is to constantly try to keep the door open, to interrupt the immunity, not out of some normative agenda, but because we know that as soon as immunity becomes total, we end up making the biggest mistakes we've made so far.
Yeah. It's very interesting because we talked to Luigino Bruni, and it's one of his topics as well. And he's kind of also saying, in modernity, when we realize there is a Tao as well, we started at the same time to make us immune against the Tao. And we have created all these structures as well, like in organizations where we would categorize or have performance management, or in universities where we do grading and so on and so forth. And I think this is indeed a core aspect. And maybe—
Sorry, and one final thing, if you allow me. This, because Luigino Bruni, you brought me to it, Antoinette, I'm sorry. But the, Luigino Bruni, what's his solution? It's agape. Right, it's the love at the highest, at the kind of Socratian, right, the level of, I go from eros, which is my desire, as you said, to philia, which is friendship, to agape, which is the love of beauty, the aesthetics of it. So there's I have to give without what Antoinette calls generous, with generous reciprocity. I'm giving for the act of giving. I'm giving myself through the act of giving, because I've transcended to that love for good. Mm-hmm. And I think that is a huge quest, right? Because as a teacher, I'm giving myself, so to speak, into that without requesting anything back. Yeah. Right? So there's this givenness that you describe in regards to, I can't remember, was it Caputo? But this notion of gifting, and then you say the free gifts of teaching, there's something, and that is Bruni's point of gratuitousness, of gift, that is fundamental in the becoming human, But boy, in a commercialized world, in that paradigm of shopping that you described, talking about gift almost becomes like being the only sane person however is being claimed to be the only mad guy in the room by everybody else.
By the way, I just found a book today, of course I haven't read it yet, where somebody brought Levinas and Plato together and looked at exactly at agape. So it's quite interesting. But I mean, yeah, okay. We're doing jumps here. So let's get a little bit more practical again. Because of course, another big area of you is looking at society, at democracy, and the relationship to education. So I don't even know whether I should use the word then, but civic education maybe. So if you puzzle that together, you probably first want to explain to us what for you democracy is, what for you citizenship is, and where then education can come in here.
So for me, there is something again Arendtian about how I approach democracy by saying, this is the life that recognizes that plurality is not the problem that needs to be solved, but that's the whole point of our existence. Then you can quickly go to say that means that liberty is important and that equality is important. But that's precisely not the neoliberal liberty of just doing what you want to do, but that's precisely to try to be subjected to this web of plurality. And then when you ask what is the democratic question, for me that goes back to desire, where you say, yeah, we have individual desires, we have particular desires, but the challenge is always which of those desires are possible in our common life. And therefore also in democracy we meet the question of coming into a relationship with our desires rather than just taking our desires for what they are. That's where I value deliberative democracy, which partly also goes back to Habermas. And all those theorists say deliberative democracy is not to spend long evenings in smoky rooms to talk, but it's to put desires on the table and say which of these desires are possible, which of these desires are too expensive, and which of these desires are destructive for our common life. And that the educational question, the democratic question, come really close to, I think, the existential question behind it. And that means if you then ask, what can you do in education? Some people say, do lessons in citizenship, tell the new generation what the values of our society are, and before you know it, you are in, what is it, nationalistic propaganda rather than civic education. But I would rather say, what you need to work on is constantly to help young people to meet their desires. A lot of desires are very hidden or not clear. And then to begin to see that, yeah, that not all desires can or should be pursued. And there are all kinds of ways of doing that. I often go to things like gardening or working with animals or resistant materials, which are all encounters with realities that put a limit on your desires, that mm-hmm. confront you with your desires.
And I love this idea that, again, I think we said it already, that democracy is not about choice. And Stefano Zamani, to whom we spoke, said the same thing. It's people mistake choice with, he didn't call it transformation, but choice with true freedom. Because in order to have true freedom, I need to be able to pull aside what's on the menu and not just to choose from the menu. But I think you take it further to then say the democratic experiment, and I'm going to come to the experiment again, is a transformation of private troubles into public issues. And here I want to go to this notion of the democracy as experiment. I think you argue with Rancière, if I don't remember badly, this fact that democracy is more again about an interruption than any stable order. Yeah. Where, of course, I say that for me is a step too far, and I think Arendt and others would also not have gone there and completely denied any.
I'm not so sure. He also argues with MOOF, which is kind of more contained. So in that sense,
I'm not against the institutional nature of the social order. Whereas Rancière would deny that that's what he calls police, right? That any stable social order becomes a controlling order, and even if there's better police and worse police, yeah, that still doesn't work because it is a control mechanism. Right, and I think here I wanted to just challenge you a little bit on this democracy's experiment notion, yeah. Which then, of course, links back to how you qualify citizenship, because I went through your analysis of the curriculum for Scotland, for excellent in Scotland, and also the analysis of the UK citizenship education. And I didn't see such a strong critique of any socialization in your analysis of those curricula as I would have anticipated based on this democracy as experiment idea.
Yeah. So I think institutions are really important. So just to say democracy is an experiment and therefore everything can be in flux, that's not what I tried to say then. And probably I should have been clearer about the importance of the law, and also stable institutions. What I take from Rancière is less that it's a critique of institutions or a Foucauldian argument for saying all societal orders always end up as orders of control. I think Rancière very helpfully says, let's never think that we can achieve perfect equality in a society. That's why he says the police order is a particular way in which we try to create equality, but we should never assume that we have achieved it. And there he says, what is democratization as a process? It is when someone stands up and not says, I also want the equality that you have, but actually says there should be the possibility for a different equality. That's this idea of transclusion. Mm-hmm. So if you just say, I'm a woman and I want the right to vote, mm-hmm. then in Russia you would say, I'm a woman, I would like to become a man, because the right to vote means that you are a man. And there he says, the whole point of a woman who has the right to vote means that we need to completely change how we think about what it means to be a citizen with the right to vote. So that's
which is similar, if I can, to your. So that's almost like saying, I don't want the right to choose from your menu, I want a different restaurant.
Yeah.
If I stay in that original metaphor.
Yeah. Because the menu gives everyone a position. And of course, that can look good. We make historical progress, that's really important. But the big warning from Rancière is that he says, don't think that we have achieved total equality. He probably also says, don't think that we can ever achieve total equality. So we need to keep going also because it takes time to find blind spots and to see, oh, wait a minute, we've got that completely wrong. Those are, historical learning processes that are really important. And that's not to demonize the police order. But it's not to say the police order is an expression of equality. We always, you can say, again, we need to keep a doubt there, the sense of uncertainty about the institutions we create and the ways in which we run society. And that, so we haven't said a lot about the question of the good, maybe, but that's...
Maybe the citizenship, right? So how do the two link?
So I think the good is to be found somewhere inside. We cannot project the good somewhere in the future and say, let's go there. That I think, it is a modern illusion that you can say we just get clarity about the goal and then we keep moving in that direction. I think we need to come back to looking and perceiving as best as possible our existential condition. And and find the differences that matter there. And then, of course, it's really important that we are informed and inspired by moral philosophy, by all the thinking, but also art and literature help us to remain sensitive rather than immune. So it's never, I'm never rejecting theory, but I'm putting it somewhere else to do its work.
Mm-hmm. I'm just kind of thinking, of course, this is also how you bring creativity into the area. And then I'm kind of thinking maybe it's also about dealing with type of dualities and finding a new solution out of that. But I mean, maybe I'm just going too far because I already have my head in the organization now.
I think here this is indeed, again, looking at some of your practical analyses, including some of the case studies where people use communities to learn about being a citizen almost. And I think that the question, and Antoinette is right, we're now thinking, what about civic education that you posit in the democracy, where I think you are ultimately saying every democracy has to be a learning democracy. There's this element of bringing people into subject, into being together, yeah. Right? And this notion of community, not as citizenship, not as achievement, but as practice, right? So I think we are, so what are the mechanisms, independent of the definition of an absolute ideal of citizen, what are the mechanisms that work to create citizen? And then I think Antoinette is already going there, as kind of, how can we take some of those into the context of organization? Because people spend 100,000 hours during their lives at work, right, which is kind of over 50% of their waking hours. So in your mind, those things that work in the state, in the society, mm-hmm, where do you see them in the regards to organizations, maybe?
I think so. Yeah, in the past, I've used this idea of the learning democracy, and to say it's about being in the practice. I would probably now more use the language of attention, as the opposite of immunization. So it begins with helping each other to stay awake for the questions. And I think that's a really important, educative gesture. It's exactly what the teacher does by constantly saying to the student, pay attention, don't fall asleep, don't forget yourself. And we can do that. So in education, we're always sort of an intergenerational relationships, but of course in society, we can help each other to keep paying attention, to keep asking the questions that maybe are uncomfortable, but that need to be asked. That's partly intellectual work, but I think that's also the political work, and all the immunization and sort of the anesthetics we find in society, they move in an opposite direction. And there I would say an organization that understands that puts something educational at its heart, but that's also something democratic, where you say we have to stay awake together for what we're trying to do.
Now I'm going to be a spoil sport again because you don't want to go there, but I just try it. Practically speaking, would it mean that we have to come to some, and I know you don't like the word, critical literacy, reflectivity as something where we create spaces for it, but also where we have practices in reflectivity? Maybe, and now we're back to the pragmatist service learning. I mean, what are, if I force you and you say, I don't want to go there, it's also okay, but maybe just qualify it, how far it is away.
So yes, we can put those words there, that it is about reflection. Yeah, I like some other words like awareness or paying attention. But you need to find forms for that. I need to take time for that. And when I think about that in higher education, it is about constantly raising the question about what is a university and what do I see where the university is drifting away of what it should be or could be. And again, that's partly the work, yeah, you can do as an individual academic, but it's also really important work to do. So those are the kind of conversations I also keep having with my colleagues to ask those bigger questions.
I think here is the, so we went to McIntyre and his theory of practice, right? And practice understood as a, almost like a profession, like the old guilds where people come together, they deliberate together, they set quality standards, they develop craftsmanship, they learn from each other. And through, in McIntyre's virtue ethic kind of theory, through being in that practice, they gain civic virtues and social virtues. So there's a, through the habituation, but also through some shift in identity over time, there's a notion that by installing specific types of not only habits, but also, I guess, as you would say, democratic relationships and mechanisms for example, for decision making or for reflection, you could actually enhance that, or I wouldn't say standardize. There are some practices that you can use to develop citizenship. And I think we're quite intrigued by that, and also by the notion of, now we have from Levina the idea of the other. So there's a relational responsibility, but we also have from you the notion of the democracy and the state. And there's some ideal of a social order with the freedom and with equality and so on. So there's some being with each other that needs to be formed through an engagement with each other, but also through an identity development, which ultimately becomes not ecological, like you say, right? And I think the question is, if that is a work, if I call it that way, which is almost like a secondary task to the productive work, the poesis that is happening in an organization, how do we facilitate that through the structures, through the leadership, what you would call teacher, but also what are some of the other levers? You mentioned trust, right? So to what degree do we need quality relationships between people? And again, this idea of virtuous friendship in Aristotle or even Agape, right? So how do we create a fertile breeding ground for this to occur? That's, I think, our key question.
Yeah. And from my own experience, it begins with, asking questions, because I think, for example, the way in which universities operate, they constantly distract everyone who works there in doing all kinds of other things and forgetting to ask the big question, why are we actually here? And I worry about that, and part of what I do with my scholarship is to raise those questions. But I also try to do it in the contexts where I work. And sometimes I'm quite frustrated, because you see organizations like higher education to become so good at being distracted from what they should be and perfectly operating in all that, but really forgetting what's the point of being in university. So to raise those questions and then take time for them, that's one strategy. The other strategy is to act on the basis of beliefs about what the university should be. And that's what I also do in my teaching. So I tend to do quite a lot of things that go against the rules. And I always say, I am totally accountable for that. So if you want to know why I'm doing this, just ask me and I will tell you. The problem is partly that the administrators don't have time to even get into such a conversation. But the funny thing is that under the radar, I think a lot is happening. And then students say, well, actually, this is much better than what we thought we would get in. So I think there are a number, on the one hand, you need to get this active conversation, but you cannot change a whole institution single-handedly. So the other thing is also to be obstinate in your practice, but yeah, it's informed obstinacy. You're obstinate because you know that you're working under pressures that distort what the practice should be about. And there is something McIntyre-y there to say each practice is there for a reason, and it's our task, our Aufgabe in German, to stand in relation to the reason and the telos of that practice. And if we forget that, then we become bureaucrats or, yeah, effective administrators. And I worry about that a lot. Sometimes I think what I hear from the business world, they are much ahead of the education world. So that gives me optimism. And I think universities run on very outdated business models.
Yeah, I would love to share your optimism. I'm not so sure, but I can see the university part very clearly as well. I think, unfortunately, because we know you have to run, we need to have a nice closure. And we were kind of thinking, if each of us just says one nugget we're taking away from that discussion, that would be maybe a nice closure. Maybe we go into vulnerability first and let you have the last word. So if I take something away, I take a lot of things away, but in addition to what we have already said, I really like this keep asking not only questions, but challenging questions, and especially the telos of the practice. Why are we really here? And why do I like that? Because it's exactly what we're not doing in universities, for instance, any longer. When I asked this question last time, I was told that's a very dangerous question because then we have to find a way to come together on that. Let's rather focus on getting bigger, getting more into the league tables, etc. So I think this is imminently important. And of course, it's as important in organizations. Yeah.
I'm troubled. You've troubled us, Gert. One, through the days of going through your writings, you've already troubled us. But I feel even more troubled because I feel like there's a challenge. On the one hand, what I'm hearing from you is very similar to our discussion with Ed Freeman and Bill Talbot, where I think you kind of, if I can say this a bit facetiously again, you wise people, you kind of take your wisdom to sow doubt. You're becoming disruptive, not because you want to do harm or because you want to kind of be nasty, but you're disrupting to create disruption that triggers thinking. And this is the figure of the ironist in Bill Talbot's kind of maturity model for leadership, right? There's you're enacting that finger pointing through your own person. But on the other hand, I have a feeling that's again very dangerous because I could project my own what I like, right, into the way that I'm in the world. It's again ecological, using your word. So there's where I feel somehow Bruno Frey mentioned this. We need to create constitutions. We need to create institutions that enshrine certain constitutions of being, of becoming, so that it's not just dependent on me being able to step into the world in a certain way that gets the others to wake up. That is, I think, something vulnerable to my own narcissism again, and therefore it's problematic in my mind. So I'm again, I think you've raised good questions, which is half of the good life, I'm sure, and big thanks for that. And thank you for taking all the extra time. And with that, I guess, final word over to you and anything else you want to remind our listeners of, Gert.
Thanks very much. This was a wonderful conversation, and I'm impressed how carefully you've read so much of my stuff. And don't believe everything you read there, I would say. We've touched upon really important questions. I have a little phrase from Martin Buber that often I come back to, where he says that the task of education is to maintain the pain and arouse the desire. Mm-hmm. And there is something profound there, that we shouldn't walk away from the fact that our lives together, yeah, have a degree of painfulness. If we are able to stay with that and can also help each other to arouse the desire to live our lives together well, then I think that goes to the heart of it. So for me, that's just a beautiful phrase to have there somewhere. But thanks
for this conversation with wonderful. And I think, again, big thanks, yeah. Gert, and everybody who has listened. Please have a look at the website. We will put all the text that we mentioned throughout this conversation, and there are many, onto the web as reference. Have a look at those. It's really worth the read. And yeah, Antoinette, anything else that we should say before we close?
No, thank you very much. Really.
Thanks a lot. Thank you very much. Thank you, Will. Bye-bye.